And thank you, Rachel, you are the best. So yeah, this is it. It'll be pretty informal. I didn't attend, so I'm just here to learn. I know that Rachel did attend and many of you also attended. I'll just kind of let things happen organically here. Yes, it's a very interesting, there's Humphrey. Yep.
Sorry. Sorry, y'all. I can't find my chat. Hang on. I super don't like this. Okay.
It is really funny how he keeps popping up right by your head.
Sorry, it's a little terrifying. They're like right behind me. I'll shift this way maybe, and hopefully it won't do it. I can share something while people are like figuring out what they want to talk about. Star Wars Casablanca crossover. She still gets on the ship in the end. So I'll share my screen real quick. So I thought that the keynote with Nicole Hannah Jones, I keep wanting to say Hannah Nicole Jones, but I'm pretty sure it's Nicole Hannah Jones. Sorry, there's a lot going on. I see Ida Bay Wells on Twitter. And so I keep wanting to call her Ida Bay Wells, very much not her name. I thought it was an excellent keynote, and she shared, a lot of people were sharing resources in the, am I sharing the correct screen? You should see something that says Black Excellence in LIS syllabus.
Yes.
Cool. She shared, or this may have been someone else in the chat sharing this. It's basically a list of resources that I thought was really, really neat. It is a list of people who are doing work about specifically Black people in LIS. And I just thought it was a really neat set of resources, a lot of cool stuff that I had never seen before. A lot of articles, some book chapters, some really interesting sort of subjects that I don't know, I personally just feel like I miss a lot of this. I don't necessarily keep up with some of this stuff in the way that I would like to. So I thought that this was a really neat resource, and whoever has created this has done a really good job making sure that things are linked and things are, you know, nicely, there's some good notes. So this got shared in the chat in that particular session, and I was just really impressed by it. There was also the site, which I'd heard of before, but kind of did a little more digging into, called Cite Black Women. I don't know if you can see it, if I shared my screen correctly, but this was kind of cool. It's an entire movement. So I thought that this was really cool. Again, not completely new to me personally, but I think that a lot of people in that particular session were seeing a lot of this and realizing a lot of this for the first time, like the work that's being done, and how that work is or isn't being shared, cited, credited, all that good stuff. So I think with everything that's been going on with Nicole Hannah Jones recently, it's just a really interesting conversation that I hope we'll be having more of, and I hope that we'll be, you know, kind of doing some work toward, sorry, I'm like still trying to get used to the technology here. There's also hashtag say her name, some things that got shared. There was one other that I was really, really interested in. Now I'm trying to remember which one it was. But anyway, the Black Excellence in LIS syllabus and the Cite Black Women features were the ones that I was sort of most excited about. So I can definitely share the links to those if people want to explore them. I'm probably not qualified to answer questions about them, but I'm happy to share them with you. So yeah, that was probably my favorite session that I went to, and which was unique because I don't always enjoy the keynotes at things like ALA and ACRL, but I thought that this was a really timely session and a really, you know, just a really great speaker, one that I think people, you know, are hearing about more and more now and kind of get some exposure to her work. And she was also really great about kind of uplifting other people and other voices in her talk. So, yeah.
That's really interesting too, just timing wise, right? I imagine when she signed on for this, she may not have known
right
of the stuff that would be going on in her professional life. Right. But yeah, that's really cool. And I mentioned this in the chat. I sometimes teach Site Black Women, because it's very tangible, the sort of suggestions they have about how to, kind of like you were just saying, Rachel, like kind of trying to highlight other people, to lift other people up, to like make visible other people's work. And they also have, like, I think they have a podcast and stuff.
They do, yeah.
Resources on there.
Yeah, and I was really sorry if I seemed distracted while I was trying to present. I'm still getting used to my office technology, but that Black Excellence in LIS syllabus did have links to where you could add to it if you were to come across some work that's not quite on there. Things like the one on the article on challenging the good fit narrative is in there. I'm pretty sure vocational awe is in there. I mean, there are hundreds of resources, so it's definitely something that I would encourage people to check out. I think I saw the name of my master's paper advisor in here somewhere. It could be wrong, but yeah, it's cool. And it is Nicole Hannah Jones. I'm sorry about that. Again, I was still trying to get my head screwed on right.
That was awesome. Thank you, Rachel. And also, just again, thank you, Rachel, for having the idea for this session. I think it's great that we can share with each other. So other folks who attended or had things they wanted to share? I don't actually know how many people here attended the conference. There's Sam.
I could go.
Thank you.
People want me to go. Let me pull up my Google Doc that I pulled up. One of the ones I went to I went to a lot of the on-demand ones. Those seem to be like pretty relevant to the stuff that I was interested in. So one of the ones I went to was ACRL Distance and Online Learning Sections panel, and their theme was on online learning, online library instruction assessment, passing fad or curriculum staple. So they had a panel of things going on. So similar to what Rachel said, they did drop a lot of nice articles and references on there. So I do have links to things. I'll just drop the whole thing. So here, this is like an editable link, but I trust y'all to not, I mean, do whatever you want to it. But there's links in here to a moving from critical assessment to assessment as care by Veronica Arellano. I see Rachel nodding her head. I mean, she's pretty, I think, famous in the like instruction assessment world. And this is about like critical assessment, which I guess I haven't done a lot of studies on or read a lot about. So this seemed pretty interesting to me. So I have a link in my Google Docs to the article that came out of her research on critical assessment to assessment as care. John Burke was another instructor, another panelist. And this was shared from the panelist Cecilia L. Parks, who's the undergraduate student success librarian at UVA. And she presented on pre and post tests of online instruction. And then I have a link on here to the LibGuide of their assessment stuff if you're interested in. And she talked a lot about the importance of reflection posts as a part of assessments, which I don't do a lot. So I thought that was really interesting. So John Burke talked about a survey he sent to students about how they felt about research through their embedded library program. And ultimately they found that they usually want to learn how to find things in citations, which I feel like is not shocking to people who work chat and do that stuff. And then there's an article on his research that I linked on here if y'all are interested. And then the last one was Jenna Stebbins from Naugatuck Valley Community College in Connecticut. And they did a first year experience assessment, and then they moved it online from doing it in person. And they had already been moving it from a flipped mode, and they're assessing how they do their tutorials online, and they use Primo as their tutorial platform, which I think some of y'all are familiar with. But I do have a slide on here talking about their information literacy learning outcomes for FYE. So anyone who is working with FYE, those might be cool for y'all in that chat. So the next one I went to was on using learning analytics to support students in academic libraries. So this was a panel of Megan Oakleaf, who's at Syracuse University, Rebecca Croxton, who I think some of y'all know, who came from our LIS department. She's now at UNC Charlotte as head of assessment. Joe Perillo, the information literacy and online learning librarian at University of Wisconsin, and Ken Barnum from University of Michigan, and Felicine Cabo from Institute for Social Research. So here they really treated it pretty informal, like they asked questions, but they kind of tackled the issues of like the ethics of learning analytics, how should libraries be involved with learning analytics. Actually, Veronica Ariana Douglas was on that panel. So we were talking about how lovely she is. So she talked mostly about like from the head of, she's head of reference at University of Houston. She talked a lot about the ethics of it and how students and like her studies talk a lot about how students don't really want to be a part of that kind of like data mining. So she has some really great comments, and they all cite some stuff that I tried to kind of grab as I went. So you can see some text on here, some chats in there, but there, I do have links to all of their slides, and their slides have links out to their research. So I'll try to drop a link to my folder with all of the slideshows in them. But again, that recording was really like more of a conversation. Like it was a lot of like back and forth of like talking about learning analytics. So it was hard to kind of grab the links as they went. And I'm not sure how useful the, actual like slides would be, but they do have a base of like what are learning analytics, the importance of learning analytics, the ethical issues with learning analytics and library work. And then the last one I went to was on critical assessment, which I just was talking about. Veronica was in this one, not the other one. I'm trying to remember now. And so again, they talked a lot about the benefit, you know, how assessment should really be about helping students, not just our jobs and what we do. So it was a very like student first panel, which I appreciate. And again, their slides are in there. And I guess I didn't grab the panelists, but a lot of stuff from Veronica, I guess, is what I ended up going to, a lot of stuff that referenced her. But I always have liked everything I've seen from her. I think she's really great. Sorry, that's the three big ones that I took notes on. I watched some other ones and grabbed some slides, but I felt like those were the three that resonated with me the most. And again, I'll try to grab the links to those slides if anyone has anything they want to add. Or I know not a lot of people went to ALA this year.
I know, I'm still working my way through a lot of the on-demand content. Like I'm still working through on-demand content from ACRL. So I shared the link to that shared notes folder, and there may be things in there that people want to look at too.
Okay, so the shared notes folder that you dropped has all the slides I was talking about. And I guess I also went to, I watched but didn't take notes on, but have the slides in here. And I feel like the slides are really, like she did a good job, Brianne Kirsch. But there is one on UDL, Universal Design for Learning. It really goes over the basics. So if you're pretty familiar with it, it might not be as helpful, but it also does do some like how they implement it at her university. So those slides are in there. And then all the different slides from the other things are in there as well, if you wanted to look at links and references. And I can see here, Tiffany put something on here in diversity and scholarly publishing, if you wanted to look at those slides. I didn't go to that one, but it looked good. And then I guess lastly, I can say, since I don't think a lot of other people went to ALA, I did a panel there, and I'm happy to send anyone who wants it the recording and the slides, you know, if you didn't have access to it and it interests you. It was a panel of librarians talking about basically like equity, diversity, and inclusion and how it intersects with online learning. So Twana Hodge was on the panel with me, as well as Amanda Roth, Dominique Turnbow, I'm missing Kimberly Shottick. So a lot of great librarians that I was happy to be a part of that panel. So I can drop the I have a link to the MP4. Don't tell ALA, but like y'all can watch it and I can drop you all the links. But the slides, we did do that as more of a conversation. So the slides are a little bare bones because we're like talking through a lot of stuff. So I can drop that link in the chat. I'll silence myself and find it on the back end.
One person that Sam, or one panel that Sam mentioned was the diversity and scholarly publishing one, which I still need to watch. But if you're in the writing group, Harrison Inifuku, I hope I'm pronouncing the last name right, wrote a chapter in the book called Knowledge Justice. And we actually read that chapter on like gatekeeping and academic publishing. So if you're interested in that chapter or that particular session, that's something that I know we've talked about in the writing group before and could possibly explore again. So, Knowledge Justice is a really good book. I'll find the link.
So this may be a really short session. Why don't we open it up? If you've been to other professional development events recently that you'd be willing to share about, we'd love to hear from those as well, so that we don't just have to make Sam and Rachel talk the whole time. Not that that wouldn't be great. I'm going to mute myself because they're doing some yard work next door.
While people are deciding if they want to talk, there was also a panel from some people, some librarians in Chatham County, which is not that far from where we are, who it's a public library, and they started like a social justice club for like younger people in their library, and they talked about kind of their experience and like how that Chatham County is more rural, and it's, you know, it's kind of weird because part of the county is Pittsburgh, which is very like sort of very liberal part of the county, and then the rest of it is pretty conservative. So they just talked about their experience with that. That was another session. There was a bizarre keynote with Danny Trejo, or was it a keynote? It was just like a talk with Danny Trejo where one of the bad guys from Blade interviewed him. And at one point, I had already left at this point, but apparently he said that he was a big fan of Jenny McCarthy, who's like a very well-known anti-vaxxer. What a world. So yeah, I still haven't watched the Barack Obama keynote, but I'm sure it was great. But yeah, Danny Trejo, he's been in a lot of stuff. One of my favorites by him is From Dusk Till Dawn. A lot of people know him from Spy Kids, which is not his best work, but yeah. I mean, it's still great, but like he's known for other stuff. Machete, yeah. I'm gonna be quiet now.
There's also that commercial, I wanna say it's for Verizon, where the woman has paid him to like talk to her spam callers and frighten them because he can sound scary. I think that's part of his range. Anna mentioned in the chat this decolonizing the catalog webinar that was last week. Anna, I know you may not be able to really speak too much, but if anyone else was there, I was really excited about the idea of that, but I was out last week, so I didn't get to see it. Yeah, if Anna or anyone else who was able to attend that has no worries, Anna, I figured that was probably the case.
I was there.
I was like curious.
I had the little tappy thing over my camera. I went to that. It was great. I don't have my notes in front of me, so I don't actually remember off the top of my head everything. I was really interested to hear. Yeah, I think so, Anna, especially because we did a group registration. Should be able to share links. Some of it was very like specific cataloging stuff. And like, I mean, I can tell you, but it was, you know, it involved mark fields. So I don't know how exciting that is to people, but I ran into the person upstairs. it was Mark Fields. Yeah, this Stacy, and Stacy, there were a couple of SCOA people, I guess, that were there. And so I was really interested to see what like non-catalogers thought about it. So if any of y'all non-catalogers were there, I would be very interested to hear if anybody else. That's very sad, Rachel.
I clearly am not a cataloger. I'm like, who's Mark Fields? Sorry. Has anyone else gone to anything fun lately? Or interesting, if not fun? I thought the virtual platform at ALA was a lot better this year. Or it worked a lot better than the one they had last year.
Was the custom one or, yeah, what was the platform?
Let me see if I can find it. I'm on my work computer and it's saved on my home computer. The interface looks EventScribe. It was not my favorite conference platform that I've ever used, but it was definitely better than the one they used in 2020, which I thought was just an utter disaster. But yeah, it was nice to be able to have the on-demand session. Yeah, the ACRL stuff. I don't know if anybody went to ACRL and wants to comment on that. I mean, it's been a while, but we do have the shared notes folder, which had, I know a lot more people went to ACRL. If anybody wants to share.
I was just trying to find my notes on ACRL and like my Google Drive is a mess, but I did get to this really good session in ACRL that is like, I thought was interesting about, it was like kind of more like a review. It was like, I think one of those paper presentations, but the people who were in it were doing like a review, and it was on working mothers in libraries. And I thought, I mean, they did a really good job of like having this very inclusive review on it. And but of course I like can't find any notes on it right now. I also was going to drop, I'm a part of this ACRL ULS professional development committee, and they do webinars once a month. So you've probably seen the like emails go out about them. I think our next one coming up is on feminist pedagogy, if anyone wants to come. I think I'll be at that one, but they're all, the recordings are all on there too, plus the slides. So any of the past topics interest you. It's on anything to do with academic libraries. So it's not necessarily all instruction or all online learning. There's been a variety of things. So like the last, the ones that were really big this year, actually like Anna was on predatory journals, predatory publications. And it was on that. I think, weren't you there, Anna? The chat was fire. A lot of people were like, I'm an expert on this. And you're like, but let these people talk about it. But it was actually a good presentation if you ignore the chat. So yeah, the next one coming up is incorporating feminist practice into library research. And then the next one after that is considering data literacy using COLFAL's information search process implications for librarians and data providers. Yeah, and predatory primer was a huge popular one. And then the second most popular one was critical information literacy in ideologically pluralistic classrooms, exploring challenges and possibilities. But there's a lot of other stuff here. One of the ones I enjoyed the most, but it wasn't as heavily attended, is one called Supporting the Whole Person with Student Basic Needs Services. And it was about a librarian, I think a student success librarian, working with their center on campus, like for students that are need-based. And it was a collaboration between the library and this like office on campus that provided like food banks and like things like that. And it was just like super well done. And they brought up a lot of great programs and it seemed like a really great partnership. It just wasn't as heavily attended. So anyway, there's that. And all the recordings are on there and you can see the upcoming ones if you want to attend any of them live. Also, if you want to do one, we'll be putting out a CFP soon. So if you put in one, just shoot me an email and let me know. I'm chair of that committee. So I could probably get you in if you have a topic that you want to do. And it's a good, like usually around 500 to 1,000 people sign up and around 300 people attend. So it's a great way to nationally share your research or projects, or it doesn't have to be research. It could be projects, case studies, anything like that, as long as it's to do with academic libraries. So a share and a plug, it's like a double. Joe has a comment about y'all's session that you went to too.
I went to one at ACRL called the Humane Job Search. It's just a lightning talk. And the point of that one, which I've been thinking about a lot because I'm on this hiring practices committee team thing, the job search is not a hazing process was like kind of the main takeaway from that. Like we're not looking to like kind of terrify people when they apply. So doing things like including a salary range or at least a minimum salary, thinking about reducing the financial burden as much as possible on people when they apply for jobs. Like I know we've been talking a lot about compensation culture on that committee and preventing, you know, as much as possible, making it so that people do not have to pay anything to come and interview, and kind of eliminating reimbursement as much as possible. So that one was cool. It kind of got dragged because, no, not this one. Never mind. There was one at ACRL I went to that I actually thought wasn't that bad, but people were not happy because it had a RuPaul's Drag Race theme. And there was a whole Twitter thread about how people super didn't like that. I don't know, but yeah. Oh, sorry. I'm just seeing the chat.
Joe, I didn't take digital notes. I have handwritten notes and there's only two pages of them. So some of them are like 6XX subject headings. So, but I'm happy to like share them.
What a wild time for ISB Live. Wow.
Yeah, there wasn't, I don't remember any specific discussion of names in this particular, it was a grouping of three presentations. The discussion was heavily, I mean, it was, the subtitle was anti-racist description. So that was really the focus. But some interesting information, especially about changing subject headings and adding subject headings.
Okay, I have another one. I just dropped it in the chat. It was at this Library Instruction Tennessee conference I went to. And it was a panel on ableism in academic libraries. And it made me think of when Rachel was talking about hiring practices. It was a panel of different librarians talking about different scenarios. So I think one was chronically ill, one had different kinds of mental health issues. Another one had a neurodivergent child. But anyway, it was just like a lot of different scenarios, and they went through it, and the slides are really good. And it was like one of the better presentations I've went to. And they didn't record it because they wanted it to be like an honest conversation about ableism at work and stuff. But if you don't know about that topic or want to kind of look through, each slide has who they are and what their kind of scenario was. And they were all like great. And they all were willing to continue the conversation. So again, if you wanted to email any of them and say like, hey, I saw your slides, this is important to me too. I think they're doing research on it. And again, it's like a really big passion of theirs. And again, that's probably one of the like better panels I've been to. I just thought they were like really great at being honest and like sharing their experiences. And one of the things they did talk about was the all day interview process and how that's really pretty hard on a variety of people in a lot of ways, you know, and like, why do we make people do that? But it's an interesting panel. Check it out.
Does anybody else have anything like exciting conference sessions or interesting ones that you've been to recently? It's a good question. Anna says, was there a suggestion for how to structure interviews in a more reasonable way? I haven't heard any, I don't know about the one Sam went to, but like in the ones I've been to, I don't know that I've heard any suggestions that I thought were super practical, but yeah. I don't know.
Well, one that came up a lot in this one that I've heard come up in other panels like this is this idea that we cannot give them the questions ahead of time for phone interviews, you know, like why? Because, you know, they're going to be doing research and preparing answers anyway. So like if you can just take that kind of one stress off, you know, to kind of prepare people, again, particularly people who are like neurodivergent or like need time to, you know, kind of not be put on the spot in that way. And I was like, yeah, I mean, that was kind of the first time silly enough for me that I thought, I was like, yeah, we don't have to do it that way. And they said that was one, there was someone who was in administration and they said that was the one that was fought the most, like at a higher level that people were just like, no, we can't do that. They would be like, why can't you do that? And again, of course, this idea of that virtual interviews have been ton more accessible and flexible for people than flying someone out deal because flying people out, you know, requires a lot of physical effort as well as, you know, if you're a caregiver or any kind of issues like that, it's kind of putting you in an awkward situation. And then of course there is this unassociated cost, right? Like you can refund them for a lot of stuff, but the cost of their time, the cost of being in an airport, grabbing food, you know, all that stuff. So again, like what Rachel was saying too, right? Like it's not really fair to make people pay for interviews in a way. So yeah, that was all brought up. Again, the questions ahead of time seem to be the big thing that was brought up over and over again. And that like, that helps a lot of people. It takes off a lot of like unnecessary stress. You know, and again, unless they're a job that requires them to be on their toes all the time, like then why, you know, which is not very many jobs, then again, there's no reason why we can't just give people that, that information. So that was like a simple one that again, I thought was like, oh, well, that's something easy. And again, I feel like virtual interviews, again, I mean, doesn't that just save everyone time and money, right? Like, you know, in terms of the planning and everything, I hope we don't completely get away with that. Moving forward. So that was a big one. I'm trying to think of what other things came up. I think, again, even the concept of that it has to be a full day, it's very grueling on a lot of people. Because it's more grueling, right, to do a full day interview where you're walking around and doing all this stuff versus even like working in person where you can sit down more, like have breaks more, that kind of thing. So again, this kind of concept of like, why does it have to be all one day? Couldn't we break it up? You know, all that stuff. So that was all brought up in that panel.
I went to a training session online that's very different, and I'm putting the link in the chat. It was about how to respond as a bystander when people are being attacked. And the first one was specific to Asian Americans being harassed, and then I did one that was more specific to women, but they're basically the same five D's, and I'm not going to remember all of them, but, you know, things like how to distract people, you know, like, for example, going up and just like asking directions or the time or just getting in the way, spilling a drink, you know, different things that you can do to be a distraction and hopefully maybe derail it. And, you know, And always making sure, you know, take care of your own safety as well. One of them is document, and then what to do, you know, if you have recorded on your phone, you know, then you ask the victim what they want you to do with it. You don't just go posting it. You know, things like you calling the cops might not always be the best thing. And that's if you can ask the victim because they might not want the cops there for some reason. And then the last one was like delay. I haven't covered all of them, but that if there's no way to intervene while it's happening, that at least you can go up and, you know, speak to the person afterwards and make sure they're okay. So anyway, it's very interesting, and it's, you know, it's people on a campus, people in public service, or even just people being out in the world. I think it's great training to have.
All right. Well, we went far beyond ALA, which is awesome because people had lots of good stuff to share. Does anyone else want to share any other sort of recent professional development conference, webinar, training, et cetera, stuff that they have experienced before we wrap this up? Seems like maybe this is something we could do maybe like quarterly or something, since people had a really nice wide variety of things. And Rachel, my eye did that thing where I read it as idea until you corrected it.
Okay. Do one after NCLA.
Yes, yeah. Actually, I'm so glad you said that, Rachel.
Yeah.
You're involved in the NCLA conference planning.
Can you
talk a little bit about how that's going to run this year? Because I'm still not 100% clear.
Absolutely. Do you want me to keep recording or stop the recording? Either way, I just wanted to check.
Let's keep recording in case.
Okay, cool. Yes. See it later. I will share my screen if that's okay. I cannot see the chat, so let me know if anyone has questions. Hang on 1 second. So, NCLA this year, can you see that? The NCLA website, cool. Yes. It's gonna be hybrid. So what we're doing is most things will be online. And that's the kind of the short answer is that most things will be online, but because we have a contract with the Benton Center in downtown Winston-Salem, they are going to have some events in person. So there's already a group registration for the library that went out, and that includes access to all of the online content, much of which will be available on demand after for 6 months to like a year and a half, depending on what platform we use. Anyway, it'll be available. It also includes access to the in-person stuff. So if you want to see the schedule, you can go to nclaonline.org. You don't have to put this wild apricot thing. You could just do nclaonline.org, click conference home, and you can see lots of information. If you know someone who wants a scholarship to go to the conference, there's an application for people working in North Carolina libraries and also one for students. But the schedule is here. And so you can see it by dates, the 18th through the 22nd of October. And they've tried to put, like, if it's a virtual event, they try to make it really clear that it's going to be virtual. So these are the pre-conference sessions. And I know that they're still doing a little bit of work on this. Most things will be pre-recorded and virtual with like a live Q&A, is my understanding. And or live virtual events that you can then stream. Let's see what else. There's also the speakers page. We have three featured speakers that are super exciting. So Miguel Figueroa works with Amigos Library Services. Katrina Davis Kendrick is a legend in her own right. And then Cadwell Turnbull is a children's author. Or just a regular adult author. I'm not entirely sure, but the one that I'm most excited about is definitely Katrina Davis Kendrick. But yeah, so most stuff is online, but you will have access to the in-person stuff if you are registered. So, and there will be chances to volunteer and all that good stuff. So once you actually register for the conference, they'll send you access to the platform, which is called Hoova, and you can like build your schedule and stuff and see what's going to be in person and what's not. I think the main things that are going to be in person are like the all conference reception, and a couple of the like, maybe like one or two of the award ceremonies. But yeah, and also Winston has some really cool stuff downtown. So, and then there'll also be virtual poster sessions too. So I'll drop the link in the chat, but yeah, a little bit of both.
Awesome. Thank you, Rachel. That is very helpful. I will be presenting at NCLA. And I know many of my colleagues here are also presenting, but I was thinking, gosh, I don't know that I totally understand how this is going to work.
Truth be told, I don't know that I do either. We'll find out. But yeah, I think, so the question came, will the pre-recorded things take place in a single room with it streamed or sort of a watch then come ask questions thing? I think it'll work like it did roughly in ACRL, which is where you come to the room and the recording of the session will begin to play at a particular time, and then it'll go off and you'll have the speakers there to answer questions. So their presentation's pre-recorded, starts at the same time, but then the Q&A happens. That's my basic understanding.
I think that sounds like what I've heard from Kathy Shields.
Yes, and Kathy is very much in charge of this logistically, and I'm sure could answer this a lot better than I could. I'm sort of in charge of like marketing and like
the, and you're doing a great job marketing it right now.
68 people have registered, so yep, there you go. But yeah, I think that's what's gonna happen, and then like I said, lots of on demand, which is nice. That's my favorite part of these, is the on demand stuff, because you just don't have time to watch all of it like at the same time. It's like Netflix, but conferences, you're right.
Yes, exactly.
Yep.
All right. Well, I feel like that wraps us up nicely. Thank you all so much.